Hello everyone, and thanks for watching Edupedia World videos. So continuing with the topic of states of matter, today we'll deal with kinetic theory of gas. So this theory will basically represent the theoretical concept, okay, or a theoretical model of the gas laws that we have already studied. Let's see what I mean by that. So kinetic molecular theory, as it is more commonly known, though here we'll call it as KTG, that is kinetic theory of gas. Alright, so KTG basically explains gas laws from a theoretical point of view. Alright, so all those laws that we studied, Boyle's law, Charles' law, etc., they are based on empirical observations of various scientists. Now this theory here makes certain assumptions, it gives certain postulates which will help us to explain the same laws, the same gas laws, from a theoretical perspective rather than just an empirical observation. So it is applicable to only ideal gas, okay, so not to real gas. Alright, so KTG should not be applied to real gases present in real world. Alright, though the assumptions or the model are obviously based on what we observe in reality and have been simplified further, okay, to suit a theoretical model. Okay, that is how a theory or a theoretical model works. Alright, so any ideal model, or whenever you have something called, say, an ideal theory or an ideal model, it means that we have simplified the reality, we have taken certain assumptions, and under those constraints, okay, under those assumptions, we are looking at a simplified picture, okay, in order for us to understand what is going on there. And from that theoretical picture, from that simplified picture, we will try and extrapolate to back to reality. Okay, so that is how any ideal model works. So same thing applies here for ideal gases as well. So this gives you a microscopic picture of the things that are happening to an ideal gas. Now, the laws that we studied, we were basically talking about the bulk gas, but now KTG allows us to go to the molecular level and understand things from that level instead of just looking at the bulk gas. So this kinetic molecular theory, it is quite important from your school exams point of view, alright, but not so much from JE perspective, especially because you do not get direct questions from here, alright. But what JE syllabus covers is a mathematical formulation of KTG which is not present in your NCERT syllabus. Okay, so here we will not cover mathematical formulation since we are only taking into account NCERT CBSE syllabus right now. But the mathematical formulation is something of this KTG, is something which often gives rise to questions at JE level. Right, so it is quite important to understand these theoretical concepts first in order to go to the mathematics part. So let's start with these assumptions of KTG, okay, what postulates are present in this kinetic molecular theory of gas. So let's talk about them one by one. So the first assumption is very simple, very straightforward, that the gas consists of tiny spherical particles which are all assumed to be identical in shape and size. Alright, so first assumption here that we have taken is that the gas contains of tiny and spherical particles. Alright, so those particles or the molecules, particles means here the molecules of your gas, for example the N2 molecule, not the nitrogen atom, the N2 molecule as a whole, but if you have a noble gas, say helium, then it is talking about helium atom, alright, so on and so forth. So the ideal gas, or let's say it can also be methane, so we are talking about one molecule of methane as a whole, are all assumed to be tiny, very very tiny, okay, spherical particles. Tiny as in they are so tiny that we can assume them to be point masses, alright, instead of some solid sphere. And they are assumed to, all of them are assumed to be identical in shape and size, as in their mass and shapes do not differ from one molecule to another. And the volume of individual molecules, since these particles are so tiny, okay, and this is also a practical observation, that the volume of individual molecules tend to be negligible in comparison to the empty space between molecules. So if this is a container, alright, this is the container in which gas is present, then the molecular size of gas, okay, that is the size of individual molecules, is basically very very small in comparison to the empty space between two molecules. All right, so this point here is one molecule and this point here, let's say, is another molecule, then the empty space between them, okay, has a much greater volume, occupies a much greater region of space than the actual volume of the molecule itself, because of which, all right, if you remember, we saw the gaseous volume can be studied at two different level. One is the volume of individual molecules and the other is the bulk volume. Okay, so the volume of individual molecules, let's write it over here, okay, is much less than the bulk volume or the space between molecules, and that is why we can assume that the volume of individual molecules is neglected with respect to the volume of the gas as a whole. All right, that is all the molecules taken together, and that is why we can say that the volume of individual molecules here tends to zero. Okay, so it is not actually zero, but it tends to zero in comparison to the bulk volume as a whole, and that is why we assume that there is no molecular volume and all the molecules are simply point particles instead of solid spheres whose volumes can be calculated. Okay, so they will not have any finite volume being points. All right, you cannot actually calculate volume of a point over here. All right, so let's look at the next two assumptions or the next two postulates of KTG. The molecular force of attractions are negligible. Okay, so this is again something that we saw when we were differentiating between solid, liquid and gas, that in gases the forces of attraction are negligible. Okay, so that means one molecule, okay, one point and the other point particle do not exert any kind of force over here, neither attraction and nor repulsion. Okay, usually the forces of attraction are only talked about because they are much more prominent, but there are also forces of repulsion present between molecules, and even those are assumed to be absent as per the KTG. Okay, now molecules are in constant random motion. So this is another assumption which you can say basically comes forth, okay, is a simple corollary of force of attraction assumption. Since there is no force of attraction between molecules, the molecules are free to move randomly and constantly throughout your container. Okay, there are no inherent forces present over there for those molecules to stop their motion, all right, or to go in a particular direction rather than move randomly throughout the container. Okay. The next assumption is, since these molecules are in constant random motion, all right, and since they are in constant random motion throughout your container, okay, it is bound to happen that one molecule will at some point of time collide with another molecule present inside the container. Okay, so, and also since there are walls present around your container, the molecule is bound to collide with the walls of your container as well. In fact, we have already seen that this collision, okay, and all these collisions together account for the pressure exerted by a gas. All right, so these collisions are all assumed to be elastic in nature. Okay, so this assumption is very important. In case you have already studied the chapter of momentum in your physics subject, you might know the meaning of the term elastic collision, and if you don't, in that case, let's just say that elastic collision is a kind of collision where there is no energy loss in the process of collision. Okay, so energy losses are absent. All right, so that is to say, when one molecule and the other molecule collide, their total energy remains conserved. Right? So energy will not be lost in form of sound or friction or heat. the way it usually does when, let's say, two cars collide with each other. You can hear the collision, so that is loss in form of sound energy. Alright, and if there are sparks, then that is loss in form of light energy. And if there is friction and heat present over there, then that is another kind of energy loss. So all those are assumed to be absent when molecules collide with each other and when they collide with the walls of your container. The another assumption here, since we are talking about elastic collisions and we are talking about the laws, okay, or the behavior of molecules in terms of classical physics, it is inherent or implicit over here that Newton's laws of motion are applicable. Alright, so though this assumption or this postulate is not directly given in your NCERT textbook, okay, it is quite implicit over here that the Newton's laws of motion are applied on these molecules for our analysis that we are doing right now. And another assumption which is not there in your textbook is the effect of gravity is negligible. Alright, so that is to say, if this is a molecule, then in the presence of gravity, it might tend to move downwards, right? Since there is an acceleration due to gravity, which will result in a velocity vector downwards, alright? But this effect is totally neglected on gaseous molecule, alright? And this seems to be quite true also, right? Because if the gaseous molecules are being affected by the gravity, then what will happen is all the gas will be present at the floor level, at the level of floor. Alright, that means the oxygen that you are inhaling, you will have to dip your nose every time towards the floor. You cannot stand upright, right? Okay, and everything, all the gases will be present near the surface of earth or near the floor of your room, instead of present everywhere, okay, around the container or the room. Okay. Alright, so let's move ahead. The next postulate is the velocities of individual molecules vary from very small to very large values. So, see, basically this assumption says that the molecules, since they are in constant random motion, alright, so every particular molecule, every individual molecule of the gas will not have the same, exact same velocity. Okay, even if you say, even if you start initially, let's say all the molecules have a velocity of 3 meter per second in some direction, alright, then the collisions, alright, since the velocity vectors in any one directions are different, alright, so the collisions will result in change of velocities. Okay, so this might lead to variation in the velocity of individual molecules and also from molecule to molecule. And hence, as a result of this, we can say that velocity of molecules varies from, say, tending to zero and to very large values, means tending to infinity. Okay, so there are all kinds of molecules. For example, if you want to see a distribution of molecules, okay, so let's say this represents fraction of molecules and the x vector represents the actual velocity. Okay, so the fraction of molecule will look something like this. Okay, so the y coordinate represents the fraction of molecule with a particular velocity. That means at any point of time, there are some fraction, there is some fraction which have near zero velocities, and there is some fraction of molecules with near infinity or infinite velocities. Okay, and most of the molecules lie somewhere here. Okay, so there are all kinds of molecules and each of them might have a different velocity. Alright, but although the individual molecules may have different velocity, this overall distribution of all the molecules together is constant at constant temperature. So once you fix the temperature, this distribution of velocity across molecules doesn't change. Okay, and if you change the temperature, then the distribution will also change. Next, since the velocities are different for each particular particle, the kinetic energy will be different for each particular particle. That means the kinetic energy of the particles or the molecules is not same and each will have, let's say, half m v1 square, the other will have kinetic energy of half m v2 square, so on and so forth, right, where m is the mass of each particle, and since mass has been assumed to be same, right, all the molecules are assumed to be of identical shape and size, so their masses will be same but their velocities might differ. And that is why we cannot talk about kinetic energy of individual molecules, because we are unable to calculate all the different velocities of all the different molecules at all different points of time. So hence, whenever we talk about kinetic energy of a gas, we only talk about average kinetic energy of gas. Okay, and this average kinetic energy of gas is assumed, as per the postulate of KTG, assumed to be directly proportional to temperature. Okay, so this is a very important assumption which you have to remember. This will be used later on in thermodynamics as well. Okay, and this is a basis of a lot of numerical questions also. Okay, once you can derive the law based on this, you can solve numerical problems. So average kinetic energy is directly proportional to temperature of your gas. If you increase the temperature, the kinetic energy will increase. If you decrease the temperature, kinetic energy will decrease. And it is quite obvious also, if you try to visualize it, then if you are increasing temperature, means what? You are supplying heat over there, alright, you are supplying energy. And how does gas molecules manifest this increase in energy? Okay, they manifest this increase in energy by increasing their motion or mobility. That is, they are increasing their velocities. Okay, or the magnitude of their velocities. That is, they are increasing their kinetic energy. And similarly, if you decrease the temperature, then you are decreasing the kinetic energy. So this basically constitutes all the postulates. There are 10 postulates that we saw over here. You must remember all of them, and you must also understand all of those concepts and postulates over there. Okay, you cannot just memorize them. That is why we went into in-depth explanation of all each of the assumption or postulate of KTG. So let's analyze those postulates and see how they are applicable to our gas laws. Okay, how they are able to explain or give a theoretical explanation at least to the empirical gas laws. First, basic behavior of the ideal gas. If you remember, we studied in the starting sessions that gases are highly compressible. That is, if I increase the pressure, then the volume of my gas tends to decrease. Okay, that is, the molecules come close together if I increase the pressure, and as I keep on increasing the pressure, the volume further keeps on decreasing. That is, they are highly compressible. So this is because why? First reason is that there is a lot of empty space, right? One of the assumptions, if you remember, one of the assumption was there is a lot of empty spaces between the molecules. In fact, the empty space is so large that the volume of individual molecules is neglected. And if that is the case, there is a lot of space which can be occupied right now. And hence, there is a lot of capacity to be compressed. And that is why gaseous molecules are practically observed to have high compressibility. Okay. So if you see here, our theoretical model, okay, though it is an ideal model, a theoretical model, it is not so far off from the practical observation. High compressibility is observed in gases, okay, a lot of time, and under standard temperature and pressure conditions, it is pretty much observed everywhere. Okay. Next, volume of ideal gas is equal to volume of container. Okay, so this was another assumption that we took. Let's understand this assumption from the point of view of KTG. So KTG says that the molecules are in constant random motion and there are no attraction forces between the molecules themselves. And since there is no attraction force between the molecules, okay, they won't try and keep themselves close to each other. And at the same time, they will constantly be moving somewhere in one or other direction inside the container. As a result of which, they will end up occupying as much space as is given to them. Okay, so that means they will not stick together and they will try and stay apart. Okay, at the same time, since they are not sticking together, they do not have forces of attraction or repulsion, because of which the gas also doesn't have a fixed shape. If you remember, we saw that the solid substance has a fixed shape, but the gaseous substance does not have a fixed shape. So as far as gases are concerned, KTG is able to explain this absence of fixed shape because there are no forces of attraction and the molecules are in constant random motion. So the molecules will constantly move here and there and they will not be attracted to each other, because of which the shapes keeps on changing and even the volume keeps on changing depending on the container in which the gas is kept. Ideal gas cannot be liquefied. Okay, so this is a very important point which you must remember. Liquefaction of gas occurs. Okay, the process of liquefying a gas is called liquefaction. Okay, it is not liquefication, it is liquefaction. And liquefaction happens but only in real gases, which we have not studied yet. Okay, ideal gas can never be liquefied because there are no forces of attraction present there to liquefy the gas. Okay, the major difference between solid, liquid and gas is the forces of attraction between the molecules. In solid, it is strongest. It is so strong that the molecules end up sticking together. In liquids, the forces are a bit lower, and in gas, they are so low that we are assuming them to be zero over here, the force of interaction between gaseous molecules, as a result of which ideal gas cannot be liquefied. It will always remain in gaseous form irrespective of what temperature and pressure are applied. There is no apparent loss of energy. Okay, can you guess what postulate will result in this? Okay, it is the assumption that all collisions are elastic. Okay, and now the practical observation that the molecules tend to remain in continuous motion, okay, is a justification to this elastic collision postulate. If the collisions are not elastic, okay, which is quite true that they are not perfectly elastic, but if there is a lot of inelasticity, that will result in a lot of energy losses over there, as a result of which the molecules will start losing their energy and hence their kinetic energy will keep on decreasing, which will result in decrease in their velocities with time, and ultimately all the molecules will come to a halt. All the molecules will stop moving, but that doesn't happen in real life also, right? Okay, so molecules are constantly moving. Even though it might seem at times that there is no flow of air, the molecules at their individual levels are always constantly moving in the container inside the room in which you are sitting right now. Okay, so as a result, we can say that molecules, the collisions with inside them or between the molecules are somewhat elastic in nature. Okay, so all these we are able to observe practically, and all these practical observations are also explained by the postulates of KTG. Last, the gas laws. So the gas laws, all of the gas laws can be explained using the postulates or assumptions of KTG. For example, let's talk about Boyle's law. Pressure is inversely proportional to volume. Okay, we have already seen this. Okay, this high compressibility, that if you increase the volume, the molecules goes further apart. Okay, and as they go further apart, the number of collisions decrease and hence pressure decreases. Alright, or you can say the time between the collisions decrease. Otherwise, you can say if you increase the pressure, you will decrease the empty space between molecules, as a result of which the volume will decrease on increase of pressure. So Boyle's law can be explained as per the postulates of KTG. Also, pressure is directly proportional to temperature. This is another gas law that we saw. So if you increase the temperature, we know kinetic energy increases as per KTG, And kinetic energy increases means velocity increases. If velocity of molecules are increasing, the collision force between molecule and the walls of container will increase. And if collision force increases, then collision force per unit area will also increase, given the area of wall is same, as a result of which the pressure exerted by gaseous molecules will increase, and hence temperature increase has resulted in pressure increase at constant volume. Okay, so even this can be explained, even this law can be explained as per the from the perspective of the postulates of KTG. Then there was another gas law, Charles' law, that volume is directly proportional to temperature while keeping pressure constant, pressure and amount of gas constant. So let's say if you have an air balloon, hot air balloon, okay. So this air balloon has air, let's assume it to be an ideal gas for now, an ideal gas inside the balloon. And the balloon is taken as an example over here because for a given balloon, the pressure inside the balloon and pressure outside is same. That is why the balloon doesn't burst. It bursts when the pressure changes. Okay, so pressure is constant since the outside pressure can always be taken to be 1 atm. So the inside pressure also becomes 1 atm. That means any increase in temperature in your hot air balloon, that is if you increase the heat supplied to the hot air balloon, okay, the increase in temperature will be manifested, okay, by increase in velocity. But since we are not letting the pressure increase, this increase in velocity will result in molecules moving further apart from each other. That is moving a longer distance, a longer path. Okay, that means the volume, the empty space between the molecules will increase, or the volume of the bulk gas will increase, and your hot air balloon will expand due to that extra supply of heat over there. Okay, so this is how we are able to explain the gas laws. Okay, you can think about it, okay, give it a few moments and see if you are by yourself able to explain the gas laws from a theoretical perspective rather than just memorizing them from a practical point of view. Okay, so this finishes up ideal gas completely. From the next session, we'll start with the topic of real gas. We'll look at the various sections in the real gas and some mathematical formulation of real gas to a very basic level. Okay, we'll only follow what is given in your NCERT textbook, but real gas and the questions that we'll solve for real gas and the theory also is very important from your JEE exam and also your medical competitive examinations. Okay, a lot of questions, in fact every year you can expect one or two questions from states of matter from this topic of gaseous state. So until next time, and once again thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos.